first, I'd like to thank ETAS for inviting me to this prestigious and very exciting conference. And I'm personally very honored and thrilled to give a presentation in ETAS Connections 2017, especially at the center of the automotive industry, Stuttgart. And this is even more special to me because this is my first visit to Stuttgart as well. I have traveled from Hyundai Kia R&D Center, which is located in a small city called Namyang in South Korea. And we have, in that R&D complex, we have over 11,000 engineers and technicians working together to develop most of the powertrains and vehicles that is sold under Hyundai and Kia brand. During the last 3 years, we have been developing and redefining a new calibration processes because of the reasons that I'll be talking about later. And I'd like to talk about these innovations that we have made during the last 3 years. And during these 3 years, we have closely collaborated with ETAS, as well as our engineers in ETAS Korea as well. And I'd like to thank ETAS for this sincere collaboration as well. In this presentation, I'll be first talking about the Hyundai's new powertrain development strategies. We have announced a new powertrain development strategies in Frankfurt Motor Show about 1 or 2 months ago. And I'd like to talk about this as a background to explain about the reasons that we decided to redefine our calibration procedures. And I'll be also talking about some of the additional challenges that we are facing in engine development and calibration side. Then I'll be, as a main topic of today, I'll be talking about Hyundai's new calibration processes. And after that, I'll be talking about some of the future directions that we want to go beyond this process that we have developed today. And I'll be wrapping up my presentation with a short summary. The first message is diversity. When we look into the powertrain combinations of 2016, we can clearly see the internal combustion engines are dominating. But in 2020 and 2025, there will be a significant amount of a variety of hybridization and electrification going on. I think it's quite for sure, and there will be significant significant diversity in the powertrain combination. And the second message that we can learn from this chart is even in 2020 and 2025 beyond, it seems like we still have to have a very competitive internal combustion engines, not just because to use it as a standalone application, but also to make our HEVs and PHEVs competitive. With these two messages in our mind, we have announced a new powertrain brand named SmartStream. In SmartStream, the philosophy is we want to combine various advanced technologies together smartly so that we can make our powertrain very fluidic and dynamic. And to represent, and we have defined a 4 main characteristics for our SmartStream powertrains. First is to optimize the powertrain structure, so we make the powertrain robust enough, even though it is efficient and powerful. And we would like to utilize advanced combustion systems and optimized combustion systems to minimize the emissions to deal with all the emission regulations all around the world. And we would like to gain synergy by optimally combining various technologies together. And last and not least, but we would like to optimize the weight and size of our powertrain so that we can combine these technologies very easily in our vehicle. And under this SmartStream powertrain, these are very important numbers, which represents our new gasoline, diesel, and transmission, gasoline engines, diesel engines, and transmissions that we will be developing by 2020. We have developed our first proprietary engine that is developed in our R&D center in 1991. This engine was called Alpha engine. This was a small 1.5 liter port fuel injection engine. And in 2009, we finished developing our flagship engine, V8 engine, 4.6 liter, we call it Tau engine. And it took us more than 20 years to completely establish a lineup of engines for entire Hyundai and Kia vehicles. But in this powertrain, in this smart stream strategy, we want to do this within 5 years, rather than 20 years as before. And this is another very important number that I'd like to talk about, which represents the number of green cars that we want to, in our lineup, that we want to put in by 2020. So in green cars, we mean by the cars that is equipped with eco-powertrains, such as HEVs, PHEVs, EVs, and fuel cell electrical vehicles. So these numbers, again, emphasizes 2 points. The diversity and the strengths in the conventional internal combustion engine technologies. So in order to deal with this diversity, we have to have a very competitive conventional powertrains. So we have to develop a very good efficient internal combustion engines. We have to deal with different type of fuels, not just gasoline and diesel, but all kinds of different alternative fuels. And we also have to maintain a high quality so that we have no problems in the market. And also, in the other side, we have to have a very competitive power electronics, as well as very competitive fuel cell system to not just to use it by itself, but also combine it with our internal conventional internal combustion engine technologies as well. And we want to do this in a very short time, only 5 years. And we want to do this with a limited amount of resources. So the most important thing right now is how we can improve our R&D efficiencies so that we can achieve these very audacious and ambitious targets. So this is one of the reasons that we decided to redefine our calibration processes and reinvent these processes to actually improve our R&D efficiencies. So let me talk about some of the additional challenges that engine development and calibration engineers are facing. The first one probably is the complexity increase. To achieve the fuel efficiency and performance targets, which is very ambitious targets, we cannot achieve these targets by applying just one single technology. We have to develop technologies that improves the pumping loss, friction loss, exhaust losses, and cooling losses. And we have to find the optimal combinations of these technologies to achieve the target. And we have to develop the logics and calibrations in a way so that these technologies can generate the synergy. And for HEVs and PHEVs, we might have to utilize different types of technologies. So the complexity and diversity is increasing. And another big challenge, as you know, is the RDE, the rear driving emissions. And we know that this is the immense challenge that engineers or calibration engineers never have faced before. And immediately after this, everybody thinks we must have to switch to certain different approaches to deal with these challenges. So I'll be introducing our new calibration process by talking about three interesting examples that represents these new processes. First, let's think about the combustion optimization. Probably there are more than 1,000 ways to optimize the combustion systems, and this actually implies the difficulties of optimizing a combustion system. When the heat is released by the chemical reaction, some of the energy is going into increase the internal energy inside the combustion chamber and increase the temperature, but some of the energies are used to push the piston down and generate the work. But many of the energies are also wasted by heat release or by blow-by losses. And the internal energy increase and the work could be approximated by measuring the indicating signal inside the combustion chamber, but heat transfer and blow-by losses are quite difficult to measure accurately. However, we have to understand all this physics to account for the entire chemical energy that is released inside the combustion chamber. And when we look into this equation, normally when we perform a combustion optimization, what we are interested in is to maximize the work. So if we rephrase this equation, we can clearly see, in order to maximize the work, we have to deal with the heat release rate, which is dominated by the combustion speed. We have to think about the internal energy, which is also controlled by the composition inside the combustion chamber, and also the heat transfer if we neglect the bromide losses. And when we optimize a combustion system, we have to optimize components which optimizes combustion speed, composition, and heat transfer. For example, the intake port is controlling the flow inside the combustion chamber and thus controls the combustion speed, but it is also affecting the flow in and out of the combustion chamber and also affects the composition as well. For example, the piston bow shape actually affects the flow inside the combustion chamber, but it is also significantly affecting the heat transfer inside the combustion chamber. And the existence of belt masking controls the residual gases inside the combustion chamber, but it is also affecting the flow inside the combustion chamber. And there are some of the interactions between these components, so it is very difficult to optimize this component by itself independently. So we have decided to perform a design of experiment approach to optimize the parameters. For example, we chose upper surface radius and lower surface radius as an important parameter in intake port, and we choose like piston bow radius and center positions as a important parameters. And then we also chose the masking height as a important parameters. And then we build up a DOE plan. And then we have actually designed 15 different DOE combustion chambers. And then we made a very special cylinder head, which has different combustion chambers in each cylinder, by building a special mold which we can assemble different combustion chambers. And we also have performed the computational fluid dynamics simulations to understand the physics underlying this DOE. And if we perform the experiment in various operating conditions, we can actually build up a global DOE model which represents the combustion characteristics depending on the design parameters that we are interested in. And then we can perform an optimization routine to find the optimal shape. First, we can just run a ETAS ASCMOS cycle optimization function. The cycle optimization function optimizes the parameters in not just one point, but in certain regions that we have interest in. And what we can find is it actually finds different shapes as a optimal parameters. And we know that in certain regions, in the lower load regions, a more turbulent and faster combustion helps because it improves the combustion stability. But in certain loads, this shape actually increases the heat transfer and it's actually not as good as in lower load regions. However, unfortunately, since this is a mechanical design, we cannot change the shape depending on the operating points. So what we can do is by applying a gradient limitation, we can actually find a shape that is in average the best in this entire region, not just in one point. And when we measure the fuel consumptions utilizing this method, we can find that there are some of the good and bad fuel efficiencies in these 15 different combustion chambers. But in the optimal combustion chamber, which is you can see from the most right side, we were able to get more than 2% fuel consumption benefit by optimizing the combustion chamber by this way. This is a very efficient way to optimize the very complex physically very complex combustion system. But even though this DOE model has significant amount of information inside, it is quite difficult to understand the underlying physics. So to understand some of the physics underlying this, we have also performed some high fidelity flow simulations as well. For example, we wanted to understand the effect of the belt masking in our combustion system. And we have performed a flow simulation. And the flow simulation that you are seeing in the left is showing the flow without the belt masking. And the flow simulation in the right shows the flow with the belt masking. And we are currently utilizing a very late intake valve cruising strategies. So you can realize that intake valve is cruising quite late during the compression stroke. And what we can observe in this simulation is the turbulent flow, the tumble flow that is generated inside the combustion chamber is quite a significant portion of them are lost when we do not have a valve mask back to the intake port. And as a result, the center of the combustion tumble, the flow tumble, is actually quite off-center in terms of the position. While for the cases with the valve masking, we can block the flow that is going out to the intake port and maintain more tumble energy inside the combustion chamber, and also maintain the center of the tumble more into the center position. And this actually helps significantly in the combustion characteristics. So by utilizing the information from global DOE and understand the trends, and then we can study the physics underlying this phenomenon. And then what we can do is we can build up some kind of zero-D combustion model which captures the characteristics of those observations. And by utilizing this kind of zero-D models, we can actually use it during the design phase to predict some of the behaviors, the combustion behaviors, before you actually build up a combustion chambers. And this kind, this type of combustion model will help, especially when we build up some kind of virtual engines that I'll be explaining later in this presentation. Okay, the second topic that I'd like to talk about today is the base calibration optimization. So let me first talk about the previous methods that we were using. When a calibration engineer starts a calibration, then they normally start a logging for a certain task. For example, a air pass calibration. And normally, they perform a grid measurement, and then they come back to the desk, and they process the data, and they want to check the data, so go back to the engine bench and then check the data and then go on to the next task. This was the way that calibration engineers were working. This is a very rigorous process because we can check each step correctly and we are measuring mostly all the points that we are interested in, especially for the systems that does not have so much complexity. However, as the complexity is increases, this is actually causing excessive amount of engine operation time, and the dyno usage is quite inefficient because we are running the dyno in multiple stages. And when we look into this grid data that they have measured, what we actually find is there are some redundant evaluations. There's a significant amount of redundant evaluation is occurring, and in certain regions, there are regions that we are not evaluating at all, even though it is operated in certain real-world conditions or in some transient conditions. And when we think about the parameter optimization, such as intake and exhaust cam phase, what the calibration engineers were doing was in wide open throttle region, they normally want to use a manual testing to optimize the parameters. And then for the homologation regions, they normally do very rigorous local DOE or manual experiments to find the best fuel consumption and the best emissions. But in the other regions, they normally use the empirical interpolations or manual evaluations or get some feedback from the vehicle side and change the calibration. But as the emission regulations are becoming more and more harsh, and as RDE is kicking in, this process has to be improved. And to improve these two phenomena, we have decided to use a model-based global DOE approach. In this approach, we first made a big DOE plan covering the entire engine operating regions, including both ignition and lambda sweeps. And we have completely renovated our automation system so that we could control the engine real time very accurately, utilizing such tools as ETAS, IncaFlow, or other automation tools along with the indicating system. And with this automation system, we were able to perform very sophisticated automation to actually measure this big global DOE test plans without too much attention by the human. And then after the experiment, we have performed a global DOE modeling. And then by using this model, we can fill in the information in between these measured points. And then we can generate a virtual grid data. And then using a existing map extraction tool or a new extraction tool such as ETAS Mocha, we were able to extract the base calibration quite automatically. And then utilizing the same model, we were able to perform an optimization routine and find all the optimal parameters in the entire operating region simultaneously. By utilizing this kind of method, we can dramatically improve the dynamometer usage because we are concentrating all the measurement in one stage. And also, in average, we are able to improve the calibration qualities because this process is immune to the skill or experience of the calibration engineers. So even the fresh engineers can perform the same task and give the same result as the engineers like me have more experiences. And we have tested this process in a pilot project in a V6 3.0 liter GDI engine. And we were able to reduce the test points by a factor of 4, which is a right factor because we want to reduce this 20 years to this 5 years. Seems like it's a right factor. And then in a better accuracy than the previous methods. And it was also quite beneficial to reduce the test points because we can prevent the drift away of the engine characteristics from the initial engine conditions because the test period was quite short. And this was also quite beneficial. And we were able to deploy this calibration process into all our engine calibration processes. So all of our smart stream engines will be developed by this new processes. Next process that I'd like to talk about is a interesting application of this global DOE approach, which is about the EGR control via in-cylinder pressure sensor. Controlling the concept of controlling engine with the in-cylinder pressure sensor is nothing new. There have been a lot of researchers working on this task. But as the in-cylinder pressure sensor price is actually declining quite steeply these days, and as we are increasing the application of the EGR in gasoline engines, we decided to develop a control method that is utilizing the in-cylinder pressure sensor to control the EGR in the combustion chamber more accurately. And the main task that we were interested in this project was to develop an algorithm which can estimate the in-cylinder EGR concentration accurately by analyzing the in-cylinder pressure sensors. The obvious method, one method, is to integrate the indicating signal, calculate the 50% bond duration or 50% bond point or bond duration and so on, and then find the correlation between these parameters and the EGR concentration. But we can also decompose the indicating signals into some principal components, and then utilizing the eigenvalues of these principal components or the combination of these eigenvalues, we can try to correlate the relation between EGR and these eigenvalues. For example, feature extraction and central moments methods are those methods. We have developed this in an advanced gasoline turbocharged direct injection engine with the EGR system. And we have equipped this car with two O2 sensors, both intake and exhaust, to measure the EGR in the intake manifold. And we applied a low-grade, low-price indicating sensor in one of the four cylinders. And then we utilized a process unit to extract out some indicating signals, and then we put it to the combustion to the ECU. to the ECU. And then we were running this vehicle in different steady state and transient operating conditions. And we tried to find the correlation between EGR and various indicating parameters utilizing a global DOE approach using the ESCMO. We found that the correlation was relatively good. And we compared this correlation with a multi-layer artificial neural network as well, just a directly brute force adapting the indicating signal to estimate the EGR inside the combustion chamber. And it seems like they are quite comparable. And then when we check this correlation in a very dynamic operating conditions, we were able to find that we could predict the EGR inside the combustion chamber quite accurately using this global DOE model. And we can actually utilize these methods during the development phases to develop the EGR more efficiently. But we can also utilize this in serial production to actually use it for the feedback control. Since the EGR control in nature is a feed-forward control, it has a significant amount of margin for the combustion stability. And if you can use this kind of feedback, we can actually use it more aggressively and get better fuel consumptions. So I hope these three examples gave you some ideas about our new calibration processes. Then I'd like to talk about our future directions for the engine calibration processes that we want to go beyond this. Even though this global DOE approach has significant amount of information inside in this model, but most of these test points were measured in the standard conditions. However, the engine is operated in many different ambient temperature and pressure conditions. And even though we tried to validate this in summer test and winter test, we couldn't even cover the RDE zones. And of course, the customers are utilizing the engines in much more wider regions. So we need to have some kind of virtual engine approach to estimate the calibration and validate the calibration in the regions that we cannot actually test quite often. Global DOE model is a big part of this probably global of this virtual engine. And when we link this global DOE model into a 0D or 1D simulations, which can account for the ambient temperature and pressure changes, actually this will be a very useful virtual engine. However, in order to use this virtual engine for design purposes to predict the performances or fuel economy, or to use it for logic development in the initial stage, or use it as a pre-calibration generation, we need some more simplified approaches, simplified models, or high fidelity simulations to actually back up just the global DOE approach. So it is very difficult to find a balance between these two approaches to find a global virtual engine which is efficient enough to run in various different conditions, but accurate enough to use it as a calibration. So with that, I'd like to summarize my presentation. We have recently developed a new calibration process based on the model-based global DOE, and we make the calibration much more efficient, and while we can improve our calibration quality as well, because the process is immune to the skill as well as the experience of the calibration engineer. And by combining this with some simulation approach, probably we can generate a virtual engine which we can utilize in the design phase to predict the performances and to develop the control logic and to generate the pre-calibrations. And using these approaches, we will be able to generate much more complete calibration sets. And these calibration sets could be validated by both real and virtual engines utilizing various different methods. So together for a better future is actually Hyundai Motor Group's vision. And we don't believe that we can make this kind of innovations by ourselves. And I hope the presentation I gave you today helps to initiate the collaborations between all of us, and we together make a better future for tomorrow. Thank you very much.